Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you, with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Billy O'Neill, Joe Dredge,
hey.
Mornings on WROK. Years in the books and still on top. This is Rockford's News Talk 1440 WROK.
7 minutes after six at News Talk 1440 WROK. Riley and Joe, Tuesday morning, clear and 19 is what we have. 9 is what it feels like because winds are out of the southeast at 7 miles an hour. Daytime high today going to be a pretty pleasant one. We're looking at 45 degrees under a nice mix of clouds and sun. Tonight, 31 the low. 39 okay. The high, make it 40 on Wednesday. Ooh. Thursday's 31, Friday's 42, Saturday's 20, kind of going back and forth, but overnight low is really decent. 31 tonight, 22 tomorrow night, 25 Thursday night, Friday night's 12, Saturday night's 7. So see where we're going toward the end of the week.
Trending that way.
Right, but man, try to enjoy the 45 and sunny skies today.
It's going to be great.
Yeah, should be very, very nice. On the last hour, we didn't get to finish up the almanac. Couple of notes that happened on this particular date in history that we didn't get to. We left off with NASDAQ coming on the scene on this date, 1971, the world's first electronic stock exchange, held its first trading day on this date in 71. Uh-huh. It was on this date in 2007, model, actress, tabloid sensation, Anna Nicole Smith, dead in Hollywood, Florida, age 39. Accidental drug overdose.
That was a bizarre, weird, sad end of her life.
Yeah. Very, very many things were weird and sad. And
her son got involved in
and married the guy who was 90.
Yeah.
And the stuff that went along with it.
Didn't get money from him or
got some, but not what she expected because there was a fight amongst the guy's kids.
Yeah.
As you might expect.
Correct.
Everything just kind of went south. That was a look at what fame can do that isn't the good
ugly.
Thing.
Yes.
Really, really ugly. Uh-huh. But she was gone on this date, 2007. On this date in 2020, the U.S. Embassy in Beijing said a 60-year-old American citizen who'd been diagnosed with the coronavirus died February 5th in Wuhan. That was apparently the first American fatality from the coronavirus.
That was in 2021?
2020 on this date in Beijing. Okay. And it was a year ago that Mary Wilson, one of the original members of the 1960s Motown group, The Supremes, died at her Nevada home at 76. Mm-hmm. Longtime NFL coach Marty Schottenheimer died in North Carolina at the age of 77 as well, 1 year ago.
A lot of people dying today.
Yep. It was also a year ago that Tesla said it had invested about $1.5 billion in Bitcoin.
Oh, that's
right. And they plan to soon begin accepting that digital currency as payment.
I think they still are.
I believe they are. Mm-hmm. Not that that's going to be my problem on two fronts. But nonetheless, if you've got a Bitcoin or two laying around and there's a Tesla you've got your eye on, well,
I
guess you should get another Bitcoin.
Two Bitcoin is about what you need, I think, for a Tesla these days.
What's a Bitcoin going for?
36, 37. So that's good. Yeah, right. I think your base Tesla is coming in around $70,000. So.
Okay. Never sat in one, never priced them. Saw one in, I've seen one in our parking lot a couple of times. Yeah. I've seen them drive past, but I don't know anything from
them. Never been in one. I'd love to get in one and like to just see what it is.
Yeah. Got a Tesla? Come on by the station. Give Joe a ride.
Yes, please.
That's so much to ask.
Let me hop behind the wheel.
Right. Over to the birthdays. If today's your big day, we've got a pretty decent birthday list that accompanies your birthday. Let's get started on that one. Leading off the list, composer, conductor. I can't think of a composer and conductor that more people would be familiar with their work than John Williams.
Oh, is John Williams? Okay.
John Williams is 90 today.
90?
You're thinking, what's with John Williams?
Everything.
Theme from Star Wars, Raiders of the Lost Ark, anything Steven Spielberg does. Conducted the Boston Pops.
It's too much.
His resume is stunning.
Yes. No, it's everything.
And when you think big uplifting movie scores, it's John Williams.
The uplifting part. If it's just big, it's probably Hans Zimmer.
Right.
If it's uplifting, it's John Williams.
And you find yourself humming it a little bit later on. Uh-huh. A theme from Superman.
Harry Potter.
Harry Potter. Yep. A ton of things come from John Williams that you've seen on the big screen. Broadcast journalist Ted Koppel is 82 today. Nick Nolte hits 81.
Ooh.
Comedian Robert Klein is 80. Actress Mary Steenburgen hit 69. We just mentioned her when we were talking about the Back to the Future movies. Yes,
love Mary Steenburgen.
Author John Grisham is 67 today.
You big Grisham guy?
I've read a few of Grisham's stuff. Everybody, I think by law, had to read The Firm when it came out.
I think so.
Yeah, read that one. Right. Read The Rainmaker.
Even I've read The Firm, and I don't really read that many books, and I don't read mysteries.
Yeah, or legal thrillers. Yep. I've read a bunch of Grisham stuff. Retired NBA All-Star and College Basketball Hall of Famer Marcus Johnson is 66. Rock singer Vince Neil from Motley Crue at 61. The actress Mary McCormick is 53. Basketball Hall of Famer Alonzo Mourning is 52. Oh. Seth Green is 48. NBA star Klay Thompson is 32. And professional surfer and at one time shark attack victim Bethany Hamilton is 32. She is the surfer who had an arm bitten off and said, well, as soon as I heal up, I'm going to go back out there and do it again. Is a professional surfer.
Yeah, she's pretty good.
That is a woman with a spine and many other body parts made of solid steel.
Right.
I don't care. I don't know if I'd ever looked at a glass of water again, let alone going out surfing. And as soon as she was healed up, she was back on the board and out there again. That is a tough human being.
Part of the price of surfing, of hanging 10.
I guess.
Of shredding the gnar.
I'm sorry? Shredding the gnar.
Yes, shredding the gnar. That's where gnarly, I just learned this the other day. That's where gnarly comes from. It's a surfing term where you shred the gnar. And I think the gnar was just like a group of surfers. I don't know if it was a technical name for a place of wave or a type of wave, but shredding the gnar.
Shred the gnar, the far cooler and incredibly more relevant way of saying go skiing.
It's a skiing thing. That's right, not surfing.
If you go skiing, your favorite yogurt flavor is probably plain. If you shred the gnar, you know how to have a good time.
Yes.
The expression can also refer to aggressively descending scary or blower lines with reckless abandon.
Okay, yeah, my apologies to the ski community. I got that mixed up with surfing. Two activities I'll never do. So.
That's all right.
Yes.
Urban Dictionary, to go big, never stop, never give up, accept the reality that anything is possible and everything can be accomplished if you set your mind to it. That is shredding the gnar.
Yes.
G-N-A-R.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And then I am right, though. I'm 99% sure that is where gnarly comes from.
Oh, I would have no doubt.
Yeah.
To me, gnarly comes from Spicoli and Fast Times at Ridgemont High.
Oh, really?
I believe that's the first time I heard that expression.
Okay. Gnarly for me was Pauly Shore was always using gnarly.
Yeah, he was.
Yes.
And now that you mention it.
Yeah, I always think of Pauly Shore when I hear gnarly.
So there you go. There's your birthday list. And I'm going to give this birthday list a good solid B.
It's a good one. Lonzo Mourning on there has given us one of the greatest memes of all time. The one where he's on the bench and he's throwing his hands. He's like, well, I don't know. And then he's like going through the whole thing in his mind. He's like, oh, okay. A little head nod at the end. Just that's a Hall of Fame meme right there.
Yeah, it is.
I appreciate that.
Yeah, it is. But you got your John Williams, your Nick Nolte's, your John Grisham's on there. Yeah, you were doing okay with today's birthday list.
Fine, good job, everybody.
So there's that. Speaking of famous names, I'm sure you saw this as well. Opportunity for the Chicago Cubs to re-sign Anthony Rizzo.
Yeah.
Well, it could happen. Bruce Levine says so anyway. Cubs have had internal discussions, according to Bruce Levine, about offering 32-year-old Anthony Rizzo a new contract when free agency begins. And points out, Rizzo is a franchise icon who played for the Cubs from 2012 until last July when he was dealt to the Yankees before the... We know.
Thanks.
Several reasons a Rizzo-Cubs reunion would make sense, according to Bruce.
Okay, according to Bruce.
To begin with, the rebuilding Cubs want to compete in 2022 and are in need of left-handed power bat who can play strong defense. Rizzo could help. They have three projected regulars who are left-handed bats. You got Ian Happ, Rafael Ortega, Jason Hayward, but they've lacked the consistency or power.
Okay. It's a slap in the face of half, but whatever.
Kind of is. Yeah. Yep, kind of is. Cubs' most consistent power in 2021 came from Patrick Wisdom, who had 28 homers in 106 games. And, of course, Frank the Tank.
Frank Schwindel.
Frank Schwindel, 13 home runs and 1,002 OPS in 56 games. Those are both right-handers. Belief across MLB is that the universal designated hitter will be implemented in the new labor agreement. Oh. That was one thing we haven't talked about.
No, we haven't.
I did see that, but that seems to be a done deal.
It's... I won't say anything's done with this crew going at it right now.
Yeah, I'm with you. Yeah. It appears to be 90% toward being a done deal.
Seems like everybody wants... It's a win for everybody except for the stalwarts that don't want the DH in the NL.
All right, Madison Bumgarner doesn't want it. All right, get over it.
Everyone else wins.
Everyone else does want it.
Players union wins. That's an extra person on everybody's roster.
Right.
The fans win. It's more exciting at bat. It's a good one.
Everybody wins except pitchers, and I'm fine with that.
Yeah.
They say that with the new labor agreement and universal DH coming in, the Cubs would have more flexibility to use Schwindel or Rizzo in the same lineup on a regular basis. Rizzo's got chronic back problems. He would benefit from a lighter defensive workload and stay better rested. The question is whether or not he would want to come back to the Cubs. Bruce says he earned a little more than $70 million from the Cubs over the course of a decade.
Yeah,
that's a lot of money, but he likely left $100 million on the table during his prime by signing a long-term deal with the Cubs early in his career.
Yeah, he did. And that's not on him. That's not on the Cubs. It's just what...
It just happened.
This is happened. That's the deal he chose to make.
A bunch of money was put in front of you. You said yes.
Yeah. I got it. He did not bet on himself.
No.
He took the money.
He took the money. Yes. And you know what? Making $70 million over the course of a decade?
That's fine.
Anybody would not want to trade?
That's fine.
Anybody?
It's fine.
I didn't think so. So, the Yankees would have interest in bringing him back, but they're also supposed to be in the mix for Freddie Freeman
because
he's unsigned.
That's some money right there.
Yankees will want clarity on his choice before they go back to Rizzo. If they lose Freeman, the Braves could then have interest in Rizzo. Brewers and Marlins are two other clubs looking for a starting first baseman.
Don't go to the Braves, man.
No, or the Brewers. Oh, my God. Cubs offered Rizzo a 5-year, $70 million extension before last season, and he turned it down. A shorter multi-year deal would be the logical route should the Cubs engage with Rizzo in contract discussions. Yeah, I know that Rizzo and KB and others thought and Javi thought these gigantic paydays were going to be coming their way, and they weren't.
No, and...
They weren't. Look at Javi. He signed for less than the Cubs offered him.
It's not just them. A lot of baseball front offices are kind of wising up and not handing out the $500 million contracts anymore. I'm hesitantly optimistic about him coming back to the Cubs. It would be a very, very nice feel-good story for everybody involved, especially kind of the way he left. It'd be nice to see him get in a game again. I still cannot believe they didn't get him into the game in his last game as a Chicago Cub. That was atrocious.
That was awful.
It was really bad. I'm very, very concerned about the back. You and I think, had this discussion off air. We were kind of wondering if Rizzo's best years were behind him.
I think we've got the best out of him.
Absolutely. I think we do now. I mean, the off-field stuff, the leadership, the clubhouse thing, if you're
a super guy.
If you're going to go young and having... You couldn't really have two better guys leading the clubhouse than, you know, Rizzo and Ross and Hayward and Contreras. That's a very nice core right there to lead young guys back. But the young guys we're talking about aren't really that young. We're talking about Wisdom. We're talking about Schwindel. They're
30-year-old rookies.
I mean, they're older guys. And I'm not saying Schwindel's a better option at first than Rizzo, but he might be at this point, all things considered. The DH is a really big wrinkle in this whole thing. I wouldn't, if he wants to come and take some hacks every day and just be around the clubhouse, off the top of my head, I don't know who he'd be taking at bats away from as the DH on this team.
For the ones who work hard to ensure their crew can always go the extra mile, and the ones who get in early so everyone can go home on time, there's Grainger, offering professional-grade supplies backed by product experts so you can quickly and easily find what you need. Plus, you can count on access to a committed team ready to go the extra mile for you. Call, click Grainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Team, and it would sell some tickets.
It would sell some tickets
that they know they need to do right
and,
now.
And, you know, take a page out of Dom's book, it would be good for morale.
Very good for morale, which so, they need some of.
That's just the buzz. It is not a done deal. If you joined in the conversation in the middle going, what, the Cubs are signing Rizzo? There's some talk that they may.
There is.
There's some talk. And that's really all it is at this point.
Yeah. And regardless of what he thinks of the organization, you know he absolutely loves the community and the fans and all that. And I think he would overlook any ill will. And I don't even know why he would have ill will.
I don't know
towards
either.
The organization.
I think the organization treated him pragmatically.
Pretty well.
You know, some people don't want pragmatism. They want complete honor and you know.
Right. But they're also running a business. Right. And we can't do that right now.
That's how it goes. Yes, so we'll see what happens. Rizzo may have that Cub uniform back on again. He may not. Then again, the Cubs may not put the uniforms on if these guys don't get their collective crap together and get this figured out.
Baseball just might not be around for a while.
So doesn't really matter who signs who.
Really doesn't.
621 News Talk 1440 WROK.
Last year was a rough.
Over 95 years in the books and still on top. This is Rockford's News Talk 1440 WROK.
635 News Talk 1440 WROK. It's a Tuesday morning, day that we're headed for 45 degrees, I might add.
19. 45.
Yeah, love 19 it. Right now under clear skies. Feels like it's 9. We'll, let's see, we're just going to continue to rise as the morning goes on, and 45 is where we're going to wind up here, and it looks like it should be a nice equal mix of clouds and sun today, so should be a pretty good-looking day. Dropped to 32 for our overnight low. That's not much of a drop. Tomorrow, Wednesday, we hit 39 to 40. Dropped to 22 on Wednesday night. We're looking at 32 Thursday, 45 again on Friday, and Saturday, we dropped to 20.
Okay. Outstanding.
Not bad. Best chance of any precipitation this week would be tomorrow at 21%, and then Friday, the big day, at 60% a chance of a wintry mix coming in.
Yeah.
All right. So that's how it looks. But today should be a really, really nice looking day.
I like that.
All right. Couple of things here on one of your favorite topics, and that would be gambling.
Let's go. A lot of money. A lot of big handles. Is that where you're getting to?
Nope.
Oh,
nope.
New York, they just opened up, had like a $1.3 billion handle. That's the total number of bets taken.
Yeah, I was going to say, for those who weren't aware, handle describes the total amount of sports betting that takes place.
In a month.
Legally.
Yeah, legally.
I would love to see the two sets of books. I'd love to see the legal, and then not that you could possibly you find, because then you'd need every bookie to get together and compare notes. But yeah. I would love to know what the illegal gambling numbers are, head the handle, as opposed to legal.
I don't know how the local bookie situation has gone. I never had a personal bookie of mine. I was tangentially attached to one like 15 years ago through a workplace. I never met the guy. Just got the envelopes once in a while. So I don't know any bookies. I don't know anybody that actually uses a bookie.
I haven't for years. My dad and grandfather had them.
They had them? Okay.
My grandfather had several. I knew them by name.
Okay.
They'd come by the house.
Sure.
Often come by the house, and at one point or another, and hand would go into a coat, and an envelope would come out, be handed over, and or the little notepad like reporters used to carry, and the pencil. He had always had a pencil behind his ear.
I got this.
Chet.
And this.
Chet was one of my guys. Chet was one of my grandpa's bookies. Always had a big cigar in his mouth. Always had a pencil behind his ear.
Gentlemen like that, and generally gentlemen like that back in the day, that's an amazing feat to do. I mean, the way those guys had to, because you didn't have information at your fingertips like you even did, you know, 25 years ago. I mean,
yeah, and this is well over 40 years ago that this was taking place.
I mean, these guys had to keep track of what was going on. I don't know if they got lines from somewhere, or if they were just, if they sat down on Monday or Tuesday and looked at the NFL slate and started making their own lines and
gave. It was explained to me that Chet had employers.
Well, employers to collect or employers to.
Did Chet worked for someone.
Oh, Chet worked. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
That's all. Chet, and it was left at that.
Chet wasn't at the top of the food chain.
No. Chet wasn't the entrepreneur who came up with this system all on his own. Chet was employed by someone to do this.
A runner in parlance of other.
Right.
Of other.
The other couple of guys. One guy was named Lenny. I can't remember the other dude, but that my grandfather dealt with. But they were all cut from the same cloth.
Absolutely.
These were very jovial, very nice guys. And I remember saying to my grandfather, "Well, what happens if you don't pay?"
You know, you don't pay.
My grandfather just looked at me and goes, "That doesn't happen.
It just doesn't.
You don't do that."
No. You know, you don't do it and stay in town.
Right.
Yeah.
But I was always raised with the, "Hey, you want to bet?" You know, and both my father and grandfather were very hardcore. If you're going to wager with someone, you're going to pay if you lose.
Pay it up.
Don't bet what you don't have or you're not willing to do. And they were pretty hardcore about it.
You pay it up. But those guys also had to be just wizards, like mathematical wizards.
Yep.
Being able to run all those numbers in their head.
Yeah, because I know Dad and Grandpa were. I know both my dad and my grandpa were real good with numbers.
Well, yeah.
So the guys that they were dealing with had to be on an equal footing.
Yeah, we're running minus 115 juice on three-team parlays. I mean, that's impressive math. I don't think he was whipping out a slide rule to do it.
No, it was pre-calculator.
Exactly.
So, you know, probably these guys all failed math in school.
Probably.
And then, I didn't realize there were real-world applications.
You give them
I thought it was all about a train leaving a station at this time and what time they would meet. I didn't care about that, but I didn't realize there's a fistum full of money that we're talking about.
It's all about getting that story problem that matters to you.
Right. Right. And once they found it, they were in.
Really good.
You got an Arizona man who won a jackpot 20 days after he played a slot machine at the Treasure Island Hotel and Casino in Las Vegas.
Okay.
January 8th, Bob Taylor was visiting Las Vegas when he appeared to have won the $229,368 jackpot on a progressive slot machine, according to a Friday news release from the Nevada Gaming Control Board. Gaming regulators said because of a communication error, the slot machine malfunctioned. That malfunction kept Mr. Taylor and the casino staff from seeing that a progressive jackpot had been won, and by the time a review of the situation was conducted and staff confirmed that indeed it was a win, Mr. Taylor had already gone home to Arizona.
Oh.
They tried to contact him several times after they realized the mistake, but they couldn't get a hold of him, they say. At that point, the Nevada Gaming Control Board jumped in and launched a two-week investigation and managed to find him and identify him as the guy who had won.
Can you explain again how they missed a progressive jackpot?
They say that the slot machine itself glitched.
Oh,
and okay. when it glitched, it did not alert the casino to a win.
Gotcha.
Man. And when they were going over, I guess at the end of the day, when you run out every machine and make sure everything's on the up and up, they went, "Well, somebody hit the jackpot, but the money isn't gone.
Yeah, we have an extra $1 million.
Pretty much, we have an extra $229,368. Wow. And luckily, being the we're as technologically advanced as we are, they all right. Give me the camera. Get the camera up on who played this machine here. Oh, there it is.
How funny we're able to find that guy, but not the guy that shot up at a country music concert.
Right.
It's weird.
Well, how hard did we look for either one?
I don't know.
The board secured the collection of the jackpot, notified Mr. Taylor of his win on January 28th. He'd won on January 8th.
Oh, man.
And he said he's going to come back to the casino and collect his winnings.
Good idea.
Yeah, I would too.
Yes.
I would too. $229,368 walked away from the machine and not having any clue that he won. And it wasn't until a review at the end of the day that they discovered there'd been an error.
It's my biggest.
I appreciate the fact that the guy still got his dough.
That's good.
How many times has this sort of thing happened where everybody went, shh?
Yeah.
Shh. Never mind. Nothing happened here.
Probably I would hope that maybe in the background there's some sort of legal accountability, the numbers have in some books have to match up to something else, and if you have too much left over,
you got to go on a hunt to see where it should have gone.
An eyebrow is raised, but this just exemplifies my number one complaint with slot machines these days, Riles. They're so confusing.
Yeah.
I don't know, they are. I don't know what the hell's going on.
I plopped down in front of one at Caesar's Palace for about 5 minutes and then got up and walked away because I'm like, I remember when you could throw a coin in and pull and go.
Right.
Now it's, put your card in. What's your account number? Let's do, no, I don't want to.
I think I've explained this, but it's worth it again. I feel like a rat in a science experiment when I sit down to some of these slot machines. I feel like I put my money in and I hit a button and I wait for the thing to stop spinning. Then I wait for see if it tells me if I won money. If I win money, then I feel kind of good about it. But after, no matter what, I know when the thing stops spinning, I need to hit the button again. And I hit the button and wait for that feeling again.
Yeah, because that food pellet will sooner or later come down the trail for you.
And I have no idea if a food pellet's coming or not until it tells me it is.
I don't know how to figure it out.
No. And I know my way around gambling and things. I mean, that should be up my alley. And I 72 lines. I don't know which line is what, or if I'm angling for Cleopatra and Antony or snakes bad in this game. I don't know.
Thing I missed when we were in Vegas, and we haven't been out. We were out in 2015. That's the last time I've been out there. The one thing that I noticed right away that I missed hearing from the other times that I'd been there is the coins dumping into the tray.
Yeah, I don't think it does it anymore.
It doesn't. It puts it on your card.
Yeah. Any place in town that you do one of the slot houses here, that's all, there's none of that. You just, when you want to cash out, you hit a button and it gives you a little ticket. Then you go over to the machine and you stick. It's more mouse, rat, you know, endorphin things. And then you put the ticket in the machine, then the machine can give you some actual cash later on. But
and I've talked about my two big slot wins out in Vegas, where I played two machines back to back, a dollar each, threw a dollar in, won $100. Walked to the next one, threw a dollar in, pulled it, won $100, all within a minute. Yeah. And it was so much fun watching $100, $200 worth of those coins hit that metal tray. I'm scrambling for buckets to put the money in.
Yeah, that's fun.
That was fun.
Now you just get a little ticket that you could take that ticket to another machine and just put it back in there if you want, because they don't really want you to cash it out. They don't want you to know you actually won money. It's a weird game they're playing.
Yeah, that's pumping a lot of oxygen in there and taking the clocks off the walls. They're up to something.
We want to make you feel like you want a little bit of money, but not too much. Do you want to stay and play some more?
We would like it. Here's a free cocktail.
Here's a bonus game. Right. Play this bonus game. Do you understand the bonus game? Not at all.
No. Nope.
Not at all. Just need to mash buttons for a little bit longer.
No, I'm the guy who's walking out the casino door with the $200 in his pocket thinking, well, it doesn't get any better than this.
It's called the quick 20. Quick 20. Just throw the 20 in there and just play till it's gone. It's usually gone, and then go back to the bar because we are done with this.
Yeah, that's me in a nutshell right there, except for the $20 part.
Not a big fan of the whole slot situation in town here.
I couldn't read between the lines and get that.
I love gambling. It's one of my favorite things. The things we've got popping up all over town are insidious and pretty gross at times.
All right. There you have it. Make sure you wash your hands.
Yes,
647, News Talk 1440, WROK.
Without the ones like you who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.